Gentlemen, good morning. I'm not even sure why I'm standing up here to do this intro right now because I think that video speaks for itself, but I do want to take a moment to introduce you to today's Leadership Lecture Series speaker. My name is Ben Bowden, and I serve as the Senior Development Officer for the PIKE Alpha Foundation, which is the fundraising arm of the fraternity, empowering principled leaders to shape a better tomorrow. That's why we're all here. You're here this weekend because you've committed to being a leader on your campus and a future leader in your chosen profession. To truly learn how to lead, just being exposed to training isn't enough. It's equally important to expose all of you to role models and mentors. To do this, the PIKE Alpha Foundation sponsors the Leadership Lecture Series, where we ask successful and prominent alumni to spend time with you, sharing their story and the impact PIKE Alpha has had on their lives so that you can learn from their experiences and use their practices to enhance your own life. It is my honor to introduce to you a 1982 initiate of the Delta Lambda chapter at Florida State University, Brother Mark Provo. For a glimpse at Brother Provo's journey, all one has to do is look up, as Mark has spent his career protecting, entertaining, and educating from the Earth's surface up to 40,000 feet. Mark first took the public eye as the opposing solo and lead solo pilot for the Navy Flight Demonstration Squadron, also known as the U.S. Navy Blue Angels. Prior to being selected to fly with the Blue Angels, Mark's naval career began as an enlisted deck seaman. He went on to earn his commission as an officer, flying combat missions during Operation Desert Storm. Mark also instructed new pilots in the FA-18 replacement squadron. Since retiring from active duty, Mark has spent the last 16 years as a captain and instructor for the 757 and 767 aircraft at FedEx based here in Memphis. Brother Provo is also an entrepreneur, serving as a managing director of a venture capital firm. He's an equities trader, and he's an aviation expert witness and consultant. Needless to say, he keeps busy. Brother Provo is also an active PIKE. While attending Florida State, he served as recruitment chairman and also served the international fraternity as a resident advisor to LSU from 1983 to 1984. Mark and his wife Cricket reside here in Memphis, Tennessee with their 6 children. Gentlemen, his call sign is Utah. Please welcome Brother Mark Provo.
Good morning. How's everybody doing? Did a couple of you maybe last night stumble out the door next door to Beale Street and have a good time, hopefully? So welcome to Memphis. Well, today I'm here because it's about you. Because about many years ago, I sat in that seat just like you are right now. And so as a fraternity brother, as one of you, what I'd like to do today is some real simple stuff. So there's no textbooks to open, nothing to read. Just sit back, relax, and soak in some of the things that helped me to achieve the things I've done in my life, very humbly. So here's some stuff about me. It really doesn't matter. It's not about me today. Today, this is about you. So I'm just here to share and pass down some information about the things that I've learned both as an individual and as a member of a team. And in your fraternities where you all are, like how many of you in here are current officers in your chapter? Very cool. How many of you in here are aspiring to be officers in your chapter? Awesome. So there's a reason you're here, and there's a reason I'm here. There's no coincidences. I'm here to share this, really what I consider valuable information. Okay? So what's our game plan for today? Today, I'm going to tell you my quick story. I'll make it as quick as possible, and I will have to say there are some black and white photos, but I'm really not that old. A lot of these photos were converted to black and white, but I promise you there's going to be some color stuff in there, so I'm not like from World War II, okay? Then I'm going to talk to you about 2 things. How to improve yourself as an individual, and listen, I know many of you are successful already. I know that. But there might be one little piece of information, one little golden nugget that I pass along that you can take, put in your toolbox, and use in your life, okay? So a lot of the things that I talk about are not, you know, coming from sitting under a pyramid and chanting with crystals. This stuff has been around since, for the human history, okay? So some of the stuff you've heard before, but it'll just be a refresher and a reminder. Some things you've never heard before that I'm gonna pass along to you. So I'm gonna talk to you about you as an individual, how to be the best you can be, and then I'm gonna share with you how the US Navy Blue Angels, since 1946, the true meaning of team. Like how that team, in 71 years, has flown the most difficult flight demonstration on the face of the earth, and how we did it. And share that with you on how you can take your chapter and make it the best chapter you can make, okay? I got some cool video. I got some decent video along the way, so hopefully you won't get tired. And then I'll take some questions at the end. If anybody's got any questions, or if you're hungry for lunch, we'll do that, okay? So here's me, Delta Lambda, full head of hair, feeling good, Rush chairman. Life's good, man. I'm at Florida State, 3-1, females to males. It's good, right? It's all good. Except underneath, things aren't all that good with old Utah. Because while I'm trying to do my best to be a great Rush chairman at a pretty decent chapter, okay, I got issues. Like one is I'm poor. I'm working two jobs. I'm putting myself through school. I'm stocking liquor shelves, I'm making cold calls for salespeople, and at one point I sold plasma out of my arm because I couldn't afford food. So like I'm looking okay here, but things are not that great. And I was really like a ship without a rudder. I really just, I wanted to be there, I wanted to be successful, but so I really concentrated on being a great Rush chairman, to the detriment of my schoolwork. So I ended up, I had two bad semesters in a row, and if you don't think you can flunk out of Florida State, by golly, you can, and I did. So I flunk out of Florida State, and I am pretty bummed out. So I go home, my parents couldn't afford to send me to college, and that's okay, I made it my own way, but my dad said, why don't you join the military and grow up? And I said, you know, that's probably what I need to do. So here I am. Here I am. Right after I finish my LSU tour as a Rush consultant, I go to Navy boot camp. They shave my head. They give me these wonderful set of clothes. Now I'm in the Navy. And guess what? That was a culture shock. Can you imagine? Yeah, a little bit of a culture shock. So I'm in the Navy, and I thought I'm going to make the best of what I can. I'm going to do the best that I can. So I end up going to this. Now, you see, most guys would go, man, I want to be on a battleship, or I want to be on an aircraft carrier. No, I get put on an ocean-going minesweeper. Most of you are too young to remember this show on TV called McHale's Navy, but this is, for the older people in the crowd, this is like McHale's Navy. Wooden hull. That ship was made out of wood. Okay, that was my life. So for the first 9 months I was on this ship, I was called a deck seaman. So all I did was scrub toilets, clean the bathrooms. Let's see, I scraped paint, I painted, and I shined brass. That's what I did. I was a manual laborer for 9 months when I joined the Navy. So I went from being the Rush chairman at Delta Lambda to scrubbing toilets. And you know what? The best thing that ever happened to me. I'll tell you why. It's because that experience changed my life. Because now, when they asked me to scrub the toilet, I did it really well. I got really good at scrubbing toilets. I got really good at shining brass. I got really good at painting, you know, scraping the gray paint off and then painting the ship. In fact, my buddies and I, we sat on the edge of that. Well, my skipper is in that picture right there. He's my CO. But we'd sit over the edge of the minesweeper with paint brushes and paint buckets and paint that whole hull of that ship. We did it in like 2 weeks. But you know what I learned? I learned about work ethic. I learned about attention to detail. Like, I learned about doing a good job, because we got inspected, and if we failed an inspection, it was kind of demoralizing. Plus, you could get in big trouble for it. So those things enabled me to develop like pride in my work, where I didn't need anybody patting me on the back going, really nice job, because I was already patting myself on the back, because I cared. I put in the time and the effort. I got good at menial stuff, and it paid off in big dividends later. So here I am on the ship, 9 months, I'm doing manual labor. One of the guys on the ship who I really respected, he was the navigator of the ship. And he came to me and he said, hey, you thought about a job you might like to take up in, you know, other than scrubbing toilets? And I said, yeah, I've been thinking about it. And he goes, how'd you like to be a navigator? Or in the Navy, we call it a quartermaster. And I go, yeah, it's pretty interesting. I think I'd like to do that. So a navigator's a guy he's got nautical charts up on the bridge, and he's sitting there helping the officer of the deck navigate the ship wherever it's going. And it's kind of cool, because you get to get out a sextant, you shoot stars, and you get to figure out where you are on the Earth on a chart. So he teaches me that job. He teaches me that job where normally they'd send me to a school for it. But he teaches me the job, and I become a quartermaster. So this was the moment that changed my whole life. So I was very competent as a quartermaster, but everything's based on seniority. Just like when you're a pledge and when you're the SMC, right? So I had a boss who had come on board. My previous boss went to MIT to teach navigation. The guy who taught me how to do this job. My new boss was not very competent at his job. And so we were in the middle of an inspection, our ship was getting inspected, and we were doing a navigational exercise. And my boss is lost. He has no idea where our ship is in the water. It's pretty bad. And do we have any former Navy guys in here that are now in college? GI Bill, Navy, Marines? Do we have any Army guys? GI Bill. Thank you, sir, for your service. Okay, well, this young man knows, you fail an inspection, it's called a change of command with no band. In other words, the skipper, the commanding officer, he's a dot, he's gone, if we fail that inspection. So I'm looking at my skipper, checking him out, and he goes, and I know that if we fail this inspection, his career is over. So, but I walk up to him on the bridge and I go, sir, I'd like to take over plotting the chart. I'd like to take over navigation. And so he looked at me and he goes, can you handle this? And I go, yes, sir, I can. So he goes, you got it. You take over the navigation. So my boss who was lost is now doing my job, and I take over and we pass the inspection. And the next morning, my commanding officer, he calls me down into his cabin on the ship, and he goes, son, I don't know if you know this, but you just saved my ass. What can I do for you? And I said, sir, I really love the Navy. I like what I'm doing. I've never told anybody this, but I got 3 years of college under my belt, and I'd like to become an officer in the Navy. And he goes, son, what do you want to do? You want to fly airplanes? You want to drive ships or drive submarines? And I said, sir, now remember, he's a ship driver, so I'm thinking this is a loaded question. But I go, sir, I've always dreamed about flying airplanes. I never thought I could do it, but that's what I'd like to do. And oh, by the way, I got 3 years of college under my belt, so I'd like to finish my degree so I can do that. And he said, you got it. So there's me about a year and a half later, Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration and Finance. Now I'm going off to flight school, okay? Go off to flight school. And there's my Marine Corps gunny sergeant right there, right out of Full Metal Jacket. And believe me, that was his personality. That he never put on a show. This guy, we called him Satan. So he whipped us into shape. And we started with 38 in my class in Aviation Officer Candidate School. We graduated 18. We had a 50% washout. Here I am getting commissioned as an ensign in the Navy, wearing my little sword there, and looking very stoic. There I am 2 years later after flight school, getting my wings of gold. And I was really exceptionally fortunate that I got to fly F-18 Hornets for a whole career. It's unbelievable. Better than any video game you'll ever play. 91, I think most of y'all were not born then, but that's okay. So 91, Desert Storm, and got to fly in those missions with my teammates on my squadron, which was awesome. And then comes the Blue Angels. I'm an instructor in the F-18 Hornet, teaching young men and women like yourself, and I get selected to go to the Blue Angels. And it's an incredibly humbling experience because I can just tell you that the first time I flew with the Blue Angels was in the back seat. After I'd been selected, I'm a newbie, I'm a pledge. I mean, literally, it's like a fraternity. I'm a pledge, they call us newbies, and I'm sitting in the back seat with the slot pilot, Blue Angel number 4, and he's like, Utah, don't touch anything, you don't know what you're doing, you're just a self-loading baggage. I go, okay, yes sir. I'm just gonna get in the back and I'm not gonna touch anything. But I had already flown in combat, I already flown this airplane 7 years, and I was an instructor, and I was a fighter instructor, and I went through Top Gun. But he's like, just sit back and relax. So I'm like, okay. So I'm in the back there and I'm flying with them. And the stuff they did, it blew me away to the point where when we landed, he goes, what'd you think? And I go, I don't even know why you picked me. I shouldn't even be here. This is way too hard, man. And he started laughing. He said, hey, I thought the same thing, man. Don't worry about it. You'll chip away at it and you'll get it. So, see, by the way, color pictures, you notice we went from black and white to color, so now we're like in the modern world, the modern age. So here I am, Blue Angel number 6, and that was in 1995, so that's a long time ago. And then 19, does it say 96 here? It still says 95. Oh, I got that wrong. Okay. Anyway, so I flew as the opposing and lead solo with the team, and another great year and a great experience as well. We got to do some cool stuff, like, you know, talk to all the kids. The real reason we were there was to recruit, was to help people get excited about joining the military. So we got to meet some great people. There's Jay Leno, if anybody knows him from The Tonight Show, and Leno's Garage, which is one of my favorite shows. So we got to do that. There's the Hoff, if anybody knows him. He liked me for some reason, but he was not a very friendly guy. This is right when Baywatch was at its peak, and man, his ego could not fit in this room right here. But anyway, anybody knows Drew Carey, Diedrich Bader. Diedrich Bader, most people don't know him, but he was on the Drew Carey Show, and there's Drew Carey, an incredible guy and a former Marine. So another serviceman, veteran, doing God's work. And any baseball players in here? Yes, awesome. Reggie Jackson. So let me just tell you a little story. Let me tell you how valuable this information is that I'm going to pass along to you guys today. So I'm on the left there. I'm on the far left. See the guy to my left next to Reggie Jackson? That's my solo partner. His name is Ryan Scholl. He's a Navy captain to this day. He's the commanding officer of the USS Harry Truman right now as we speak. He was a Scholastic All-American running back at Princeton with a computer and electrical engineering double degree. That's my solo partner, okay? And he, at that time, he had 18-inch arms. And look at Reggie Jackson. He's a big dude, man. He was a big dude. I mean, my buddy could bench 4 plates for reps, and Reggie was bigger than him, so I was like, whoa, and a really nice guy as well. But what's interesting about this, my relationship with my solo partner is Here I am. I'm a college flunky. And I'm training that guy right there who went to Princeton, who was a scholastic All-American high school football player and a four-year starting running back for Princeton. I'm teaching him how to be a Blue Angel pilot. It's kind of strange, isn't it? So what I'm here to tell you is the stuff I've got to share with you is pretty valuable, okay? We got to do some cool stuff like fly over San Francisco. There's Alcatraz Island. Here's a little sightseeing around the Golden Gate. It's kind of fun. And, well, we got to do some really cool, fun stuff, like fly 6 feet off the ground going 600 miles an hour. That was kind of fun, too. All right. So right now I'm going to get into stuff that can help you as an individual person. Then I'm going to get into the team stuff, okay? So I'm a big believer that how you think, your worldview, and your philosophies about life are definitely going to affect your attitudes about life, and it's definitely going to affect your actions. So please, some of these things, think of this as chicken soup for the Pikes, okay? So these are going to be short statements. Some of them are longer than others, and I'll talk to them. But just soak this stuff in, okay? Because I'm telling you, this stuff will help you a lot. Under-promise and over-deliver. Need I say more? Always do more than what's expected of you. A lot of people say make a commitment. What does that mean? I mean, what the heck is a commitment? Well, to me, a commitment is when you make a commitment to someone or something, whatever it takes, you do it. When you do that repeatedly over time, you become an honorable man. You develop integrity. People trust you. It also gives you the ability to say no, that I can't commit to that. It's very powerful. Once you make a commitment, whatever it takes, that's what it takes. But also, you can say, I'm sorry, I can't do it. I can't make that commitment because you know that you can't do it. And it gives you the power to say yes and the power to say no. In my tour of the blues, I met a lot of rich people, a lot of rich, affluent people, a lot of people that most people would admire. Some of them were criminals and crooks. It's amazing. What really counts is your soul. Keep your soul clean. That's what really counts. Cheating people, lying about stuff, it comes back to bite you in the end. As you walk through your path in life, a lot of it you got to do on your own, but a lot of it is going to be people helping you along the way. And when you show motivation and you show perseverance to somebody who can help you, they will. They'll literally fall over themselves to help you in your life. It's absolute fact. You ask all the old guys here, they can tell you that. I used to fly a lot with FedEx to New Delhi and Mumbai in India. And it really was a wake-up call for me because the people over there are absolutely fantastic, wonderful, warm people. But I would look and fly into Mumbai, for example, which on the perimeter of the international airport in Mumbai, it is a... Did anybody ever see the movie? What was the movie called? Slumdog Millionaire. Anybody ever seen that movie? That was not a movie set. That was like for real. And you could see it coming in on final approach. So, you know, when you think your life's bad, if you just go, man, I know I got it bad right now, but somebody else got it way worse than me, it'll kind of cheer you up, okay? This is so profound, I cannot say it enough. So Steve Jobs, the co-founder of Apple, billionaire, extremely successful, reported to be somewhat of a tool, but he comes down with pancreatic cancer, and no amount of money could give him more time. And you know, when you're in college, you feel like you're immortal, like you're gonna live forever. But I can tell you right now, it ain't true. So be very careful with your time. Don't be anal about it, but just be careful with your time. Don't waste time. Time is precious. And the day you leave this earth, you know, you want to look back and you want to make sure that the undertaker is sorry, okay? I saw this a lot when I was on active duty in the military as a fighter pilot, jealousy amongst fighter pilots. I'm telling you, lose that. Jealousy and envy, doesn't work. What you need to do is somebody who's much better at something than you, you know, admire those guys and go, man, I'd like to be like that. And you know what I used to do when I first became an instructor? I grabbed the best Top Gun trained fighter pilot instructor and I said, dude, I'm not that good. I'd like to get better. Would you help me? And the guy was like, yeah, man, I'll help you. He was shocked. And I wasn't jealous of the guy. I didn't envy him. I admired the guy. So it does work. If you don't dream, I'll tell you, it's a sad life. You got to dream. And don't be afraid to dream big. Because the dreams that you dream right now and in the future, and your dreams are going to change in your life, I'm telling you, it will cast the road for your success and fulfilling that dream. Do we have any wrestlers in here? Awesome. So a little bit of pain involved in that sport. Think your pain level is, you know, when you first start, it's about here, right? And then you realize that you can go here. And then you're able to go here. So feeling a little bit pain, whether it's just emotional pain or physical pain, it's not necessarily a bad thing. It'll help you grow, builds character. It's good. Failing is okay. Failing is okay. Quitting is not okay. Giving up ain't the way to do it. If you're passionate about something, you want to do something, accomplish something, failing is okay. Then you learn why you failed, and you don't fail again. And then you succeed. But quitting's not good. You don't want to quit. I went from being a flunky to training the Princeton guy. So no matter where you are right now, if you're on a bad path, you can change it. You can change it anytime. It's up to you, but you can do it. When you get out of college, your college degree will get you to a job interview. The rest of your life is up to you. I was a managing director of a venture capital firm with a bachelor of science degree in business. Then I get an underling that I'm supposed to mentor to, and he got an MBA from Harvard. And he shows up, and he's working for me, and he sits in his office, he's got his Harvard diploma up here with his MBA, and he's lazy, and he wants to get paid $250,000 a year. And I take him aside, and I go, dude, it doesn't work like that. That sheepskin got you in the door. Now you got to get working. You got to get to work. So once you graduate, most of what you learned in college, unless you are an accountant, a lawyer, a doctor, or an engineer, most of what you learned in college, it's gone. And then you got to really start learning, like in the real world. So here's a good formula. Remember this in math in grade school? Rate, you know, 50 miles an hour times 1 hour equals 50 miles in an hour. This is a great formula. I would write that down. This is how you become successful in life. You're passionate about something, you focus in on it, and put the blinders on, and then you apply time, effort, and patience. And that's when you become successful. That's the formula in life to be successful. Self-educate yourself, be curious about life. Go out there and gain as much knowledge as you can as you move through your life. I wasted a lot of time in class. A lot of times I didn't go to class because I was so scared of failing that I failed. So don't waste time. When you're in class, focus in, learn what you need to know, get in, get out, have fun in your off time. There's plenty of time to have fun. If you live to be 80 years old, literally, it's 29,200 days, not including leap years, okay? So for the price of a mid-sized car, and you're fortunate to live to be 80, that's how many days you got. Doesn't seem like a lot to me. So make the most of those days. I'll also tell you this. You'll be amazed at how many of your buds that influenced you in a bad way. When you're 40 years old and unhappy, you'll be wondering where those guys are that kind of led you down the wrong path. They're gone. You never see them again. So be very careful of how you choose your friends, because they will have a profound influence on you. Much of what you accomplish in your life is going to be on simple choices, because guess what? Who in here works out? I bet you a lot of you guys work out, right? You either run or you lift or you do something, right? Well, you can. That's a simple choice. I'm going to go work out. Another simple choice is I'm going to go down and pig out on cupcakes and, you know, ice cream. But it's those simple choices that make all the difference in your life. And they're easy to do. Simple choices are easy, but they're also easy not to do. What you've got to eliminate is the easy not to do. You've got to make the simple choices of to do. The positive things, the things that are going to set you up for success. We used to have this thing in our fighter squadron called the excuse matrix. So we'd come back from a mission, and we'd debrief the mission, and these guys they'd come up with all these excuses for why they didn't do something correctly or why they made a mistake. And it's like, no, dude, there are no excuses. You just admit you made a mistake, and you move on, and you fix it, okay? I'm telling you, if you live your life like this, I think you'd be relatively happy. And that is the aw shucks mentality. You know, we could have hired, at the Blue Angels, we could have hired some great fighter pilots who were very full of themselves. We never did. We never hired somebody like that. And it's because their arrogance came across to the American public at air shows. They would display that arrogance, and we didn't want that. We wanted guys who loved people, guys who could fly well but were humble about it. I'm telling you, this is the aw shucks way of living, and it's great, and it works. And if you don't believe it, this is from Jeff Foxworthy. He came up with this, and it's absolute fact. You know, you think you're up on the pedestal and everything's going great, and you're about three decisions away from complete and utter disaster. So, you know, I think about this, and I stay humble because of it. Be a good sport. Be a good sport, whether you win or lose. Win with grace, lose with grace. And also, learn to laugh at yourself. Hey, if you're the one who first makes fun of themselves, you know, then how can your buddies make fun of you? You've already made fun of yourself. That's called self-deprecating, right? So be the first one to make fun of yourself. Don't take yourself so seriously. Because when you do, and you put yourself on the pedestal, that's when your buds are going to knock you down off the pedestal. Okay, this is a busy slide. So if you don't want to read it, don't worry about it. What this says here is that when you take on something that's really challenging and difficult, chip away at it a little bit at a time. Chip away at it a little bit at a time, and just, one, you know, kind of like football coaches, one brick at a time. And that's how you'll master things like playing the piano or flying an aircraft at 6 feet off the ground doing 600 miles an hour, flying inverted 200 feet off the ground doing 500 miles an hour. A couple more left, and then we're going to go on to the big stuff. And then we'll be done. Your friends will have a profound influence on your life. Pick them very carefully. You ask all the older gentlemen here in the room, and they will tell you it's absolute fact. If you stay friends that are negative, that are Debbie Downers, Betty Buzzkills, they will bring you down. So, hang out with people that you like, that you want to be around, that you got a good buzz, a good feeling from. And it'll have a profound effect on your life. Boy, this is a big one. you know, I walked away when I was asked to come here today. I walked away from 3 days of flying because this is really important to me, to pass the baton to you all right here. It means way more to me than any amount of money. And as leaders in your chapters, be willing to pass the baton, man. You're going to mentor to young men who are aspiring to be in your job, you know? Mentor to them, pass the baton, show them how to do it. It's such a good feeling when you do that. Most of you in here are chapter presidents, treasury. I mean, so you're already serving your chapter, which is a wonderful thing. And when you do that, it comes back tenfold. Your life is, I'm telling you, man, 29,200 days. So fill it, build your life like a tapestry, rich, intricate, and full of details. I mean, take the time to be excited about your own life and about the life that you share with other people. All right, here we go. Now we're switching over, so everybody wake up. Most people are awake, so that's good. All right, so here's what we're gonna talk about real quick about the team building stuff. I'm gonna talk to you a little about center point. It's a concept, it's a way of thinking. Then we're gonna go into how do you prepare to win? And then we're gonna talk about spun gold, which is debriefing, because I mean, I do keynote speaking to corporate America, and companies do not debrief their results. They just don't do it. And they don't know how to do it in a way that doesn't piss somebody off. So we go to corporate America and we teach companies how to debrief their results so that they can figure out what went wrong, how can they fix it and get better and achieve success. All right, so center point is always, the Blue Angels have a center point. Has anybody been to a Blue Angels air show or Thunderbirds air show? Please raise hands. Okay, fantastic, thank you. So every Blue Angel and Thunderbirds air show is done with a center point. It's like a trailer. And all the maneuvers are based off that or around that. And that's also kind of a metaphor for, you know, to get on the Blue Angel team, we all have to kind of buy in to the shared values, the mission of the team, which is to be the best flight demonstration team in the world. And if we didn't have that buy-in from everybody, we wouldn't be able to do the stuff like this that you're looking at right here. Another thing you gotta have on a team is, it's big time, it's trust. So let me explain trust to you. So I had 3 crew chiefs of my plane when I was on the Blue Angels. And I've been flying airplanes for 31 years. There was only one time in my career where I never did a walk around or a pre-flight of that airplane. To this day, I mean, my first officer does it or I do it because I'm an instructor. But my whole career, I always pre-flighted my own airplane, except when I was a Blue Angel. I never pre-flighted my airplane. I trusted my crew chiefs, my 3 crew chiefs, to pre-flight my airplane for me. And I would just walk out there and strap in and go fly. I put my life in their hands. I trusted them with my life. And I still maintain contact with these guys. That's trust. You trust someone with your life. This is my solo partner and I doing the knife edge pass. That is trust. That is real trust because we're 10 feet apart there with about 900 miles of closure. And I'm not exaggerating. So his job when we were doing maneuvers was don't hit me. His contract with me was he would not hit me. And my contract with him was I would fly a very straight line for him to separate his distance from me. So that was trust. That's true trust. Let me tell you something. The Blue Angels, it starts at the front. The flight leader, the boss of the Blue Angels, he is no poser. This dude can fly. And don't you want that in a leader? You want the man or the woman to be like on top of their game. Well, let's talk about prayer and win. How do you win? How do you get there? How do you become the best flight demonstration in the world? How do you become the best chapter? How do you do that? Okay, well, I can tell you, it's real simple. It's called lather, rinse, repeat. Lather, rinse, repeat. It's repetition. So there's like four stages of learning. Maybe any psychology majors in here? Anybody? Not one hand, that's probably good. So the four stages of learning. Unconscious incompetence. I don't know what I don't know. Conscious incompetence. I know what I don't know. Conscious competence. I know, but I got to think about it. And then the ultimate stage of learning is unconscious competence, meaning I don't have to think about it. I just do it. It is in the unconscious part of my mind. So that's what you try to get to. And in our world, in this world, this is a Top Gun quote in Top Gun today. So you got to practice well. Just like Michael Jordan said, you know, you win basketball games by how you practice. So you got to practice well. You got to train exactly like you're going to do it in real life. We could not fly if we did not practice exactly the way we're going to do it in the show. So for example, we flew for 3 months in winter training to learn how to fly the Blue Angel demonstration. We flew 2 to 3 times a day, Monday through Saturday. A lot of flying. Lather, rinse, repeat, lather, rinse, repeat, and after a while, you get okay at it, okay? So this guy right here, he flew in our back seat. He didn't do well. I don't have the video here today, but he didn't do very well with us. He wasn't very well prepared, and he was having a hoot and a holler in time, but it didn't work out well for him because he passed out a whole bunch of times. But here's a young lady who's a weather lady, and she flew in our back seat, and so let's take a look at how her day went.
Here we go. Squeeze those legs. Take a deep breath. Ready, hit it. All right, there's 5.5, there's 6, and stay. Keep squeezing, keep squeezing, keep squeezing, keep breathing. Here we go, 5.
Yes, that's me passing out. In my defense, I'm going over 700 miles per hour and pulling over 6 G's without a G-suit.
How you feeling?
I passed out.
Sure enough. All right. Oh, that's great. So that's what happens when you prepare. So one of the things we did with the Blues when we were preparing for an air show is we would sit at a table, at a conference table, and we'd actually close our eyes, and the boss would go through the cadence of the air show, of the actual maneuvers. And it was really a surreal experience because we would visualize in our minds. Our eyes are closed and we're visualizing the maneuvers that we're gonna do. And so I'm gonna show you a quick video of the boss, of my flight leader, who is now a professional keynote speaker and a really great guy. I'm gonna show you how close, how similar it was for him to brief the flight demonstration and actually fly it in the airplane.
Come as a boy. Coming right. Wings are level. Smoke on.
A little more. Adding
power. Easing the pull. Easing power.
Easing more power.
That's how we were able to do what we did. We visualized something really extremely hard. This is the hardest flight I've ever done in my life. It was harder than combat and Desert Storm. This was by far the hardest flight I've ever done in my career flying. And that's how we did it. It's visualizing what we're gonna do and then execute it. And we couldn't do fun stuff like this unless we communicated well, so that's incredibly important too. We couldn't do stuff like this either. So does that look pretty close? Okay, so I'm gonna tell you, that is no visual illusion, because a lot of the maneuvers we did, especially when I was a newbie and I didn't know what the guys, when I didn't know what they were doing, I could, if there was no canopy there, I could literally take my hand, put it out, and touch the wing of the other airplane. If you don't believe me, watch this. I told you. When I first saw that, when I was a newbie, and I was sitting in the back seat as self-loading baggage, and I saw that, it blew my mind, man. I'm like, there's no way. So, all right. That maneuver was a maneuver that I did with my solo partner, and that took, I cannot tell you how many hundreds of times to even get it to look as good as that. It was incredibly difficult. Okay, so a great leader leads by example, not a poser. A great leader pulls or extracts talent from their people. And what it does not involve in is, it ain't about me. So if you're a leader, it's not about you. It's about your team. It's about your people. That's what counts. It ain't about yourself. It ain't about your ego. You're serving your team. You're serving others. So what I encourage you to do is develop pure curiosity about everybody that's in your chapter, about all your brothers, your pledges. Find out a little bit about them. Find out what their talents are, what their strengths are. Because you'll never know what kind of talents and strengths you will find. All right, let's talk about debrief. This is gonna be quick because we're running out of time here. This is the most valuable thing that I can talk to you about today. Because debriefing is what corporate America doesn't do. It's what, when you teach corporate America to do it, they freak out over it. Because nobody wants to hurt people's feelings. They don't wanna, you know, admit mistakes. But you know what? It's okay. It's okay to admit mistakes, and if you all do it, and especially from the top down. See, our flight leader used to start our debriefs. Our boss, Blue Angel number one, he would start our debriefs, and he would admit all of his own mistakes that he made. And guess what? If he's willing to admit it, why shouldn't I be willing to admit it, right? So it starts from the top down. It's incredibly powerful because you all learn from each other's mistakes, and it's not a weakness. People think that admitting a mistake is a weakness. Oh, no. It's a strength, because you learn from others' weaknesses and you get better. And you learn and may not make the mistake that another person's made. So you learn from them. So it's incredibly powerful. Here's a debrief. Here's a Blue Angel debrief. This is my solo partner's debrief right here. So there's four flights right there, and you see the large font seconds right there? Our goal was to land Blue Angel 1 and 2 15 seconds apart. Blue Angel 3, 15 seconds later. 15 seconds, 15 seconds, and guess what? Well, we almost reached it. So perfection was 15 seconds. That was our self-imposed perfection, and we didn't quite get there. He didn't quite get there, but he got close. So day 2 wasn't that good of separation. But first day, last day, not bad. So we always were chasing perfection, but we never quite got there. But we measured it. We measured it and we debriefed it, and we every little thing that we did, like all the canopies coming down at the same time, the smoke coming on. I mean, little anal things. But guess what? We're always chasing perfection. We never reached it. But man, we got pretty decent at this stuff. So, two last videos. If you're not willing to admit your mistakes and confront the times when you do fail, then things happen. And in my world, in the fighter pilot world, bad things happen. Okay? So this next video you're going to see is one of my U.S. Air Force Thunderbird brothers who has incorrectly set his altimeter setting in his airplane. Altimeter meaning the altitude of the airplane when he started. We always set it at 0 feet when we flew air shows. He forgets, he makes a simple error, and he sets the actual field elevation in Mountain Home, which is about 1,500 feet above sea level. And this is what happens with that one simple error. And maybe we'll come back to birth to compare. I guess there is no one to blame. We're leaving ground. Will things ever be the same again? It's the final countdown. So you see, in my world, little mistakes can turn deadly and can go bad real fast. This young man, he survived. But I guarantee you, when he went to work that day to go fly this flight in Mountain Home, he didn't expect to be doing that. So when you debrief, these are a couple of different methods to debrief properly so you're not hurting anybody's feelings. The boss always starts the debrief. The leader starts the debrief. The leader admits their mistakes. And then everybody else, why wouldn't they be willing to admit their mistakes? You never put the individual person, you're not pointing a finger at the person that made a mistake. You're just saying a mistake was made. You're leaving it very impartial or very neutral. A mistake was made. Why was a mistake made? And how can we fix it? And then you fix it with no emotions about it, no hurt feelings. You know, you're not telling the person he's bad or a bad human being. You're just saying, hey, there was a mistake here. How did it happen? Why did it happen? And how we fix it. And you move on. You never, ever go over. You always try to start on time, end on time. Like, guess what? I'm looking at my watch. I got 3 minutes. So we're gonna end on time today. So you guys can go eat, and I'm probably gonna join you. And you always end on a high note. So whenever you flew the worst Blue Angel flight demonstration, you almost died because you almost hit each other, then you had to get out of the airplane and go meet the crowd, talk to little kids, sign autographs and do all that. So at the end of our debriefs, we would always, no matter how bad we flew or how many mistakes we made, we would always say, glad to be here, boss. Because you know what? There are thousands of naval aviators who wanted to have this job, and we were just lucky to be there. So you always end on a high note. Stay positive. And let me tell you, this word right here, lose this word from your vocabulary. Try is a dangerous word. You know why? Because it gives you an out. There is no try in life. There's do. Don't try, just do. Kind of like the Nike thing, right? But I'll give you an example. So we're all gonna get up, we're gonna get into an Airbus A380, which can probably fit all of us, okay? We're gonna get into that Airbus 380, and I'm gonna sit in the left seat of the cockpit with my co-pilot, and I'm gonna get on the microphone and say, hey, welcome Pike Brothers. Today we're gonna fly to Las Vegas, but we're gonna try to get there. We're gonna try. We don't really know if we are, but we're gonna try. You see, in my world, there is no try, you just do. All right, so, this is what we talked about today. I told you my story, share with you some concepts, some philosophies, a way to think about life, for you as an individual. Also, some thoughts about how to build a great team, and kind of the way the Blue Angels did it. Hopefully we had some cool video along the way. And I think we're a little late for Q&A, which is fine. So let me tell you, when you put all these elements together, you combine them, it becomes very powerful. And if you do that the right way, it turns out like this. To close with this. It was a privilege to be with you all today. Hopefully I can get to talk to some of you over lunch. I was very privileged to be a Pike. Thank you very much to Pike Kappa Alpha National Headquarters here in Memphis for inviting me. And Pikes rock.
Chad Williams, president of the fraternity.
Nice to meet you, sir.
Thank
pleasure.
Meet J.J. Arnold, president of the university.
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you, too,
Chad,
sir.
And I'd like to present to you on behalf of the Pike Kappa Alpha fraternity, the Pike University Board of Directors, and its foundation, a certificate thanking you for being here and presenting and sharing your wisdom with us, as well as a lapel pin that saying you're certified as a Pike AA certified and you attended Pike University. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it. Thank you, I need that. I lost my original one.
So you can hear me. So as you've probably seen in the advertisement for this event, we're entering our 150th year of the fraternity. So the Supreme Council has commissioned a coin, and familiar to you probably as a challenge coin.
Yes,
so
sir.
So we've created a council-created challenge coin with the fraternity's logo, the 150th logo, and then the great seal of the fraternity on the other side, which is only used in council commissioned items. We'd like, this is a limited supply. We would like you to have one. Thank you so much for being here. This was wonderful.
Oh, yes, sir. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. I've got, where, is it in here? Oh, it's right here.
Gentlemen.
I treasure these very much, but there is quite an amazing memorial at the headquarters with all the veterans that have been Pikes, and so I'd like to donate. You can put this in a back closet somewhere on a hanger, it doesn't matter. I'd like to donate one of my flight suits.
Wow.
To sure.
Can I wear it the rest of the weekend?
You could actually probably still fit in it. I can't. Yeah.
So thank you.
There we go,
much.
Sir.
So I've got one question for you, though. So you're 6 feet off the ground, going 600 miles an hour. What error has to happen for you to hit the ground?
Well, that wasn't me, by the way.
Yeah, I know. That was actually Thunderbird. I noticed with the Thunderbird, the guy that ejected, right?
Yeah, that
not
guy. No, he was a Thunderbird, but I don't hold that against him. We have a it's funny because like the Thunderbirds and the Blue Angels have a sibling rivalry, kind of like Pikes and you know Sigma Chi or Pikes and Lambda Chi, you know that kind of thing. But he ejected literally like a quarter of a second before ground impact. He was very very fortunate. My buddy who was in that picture, it's as though you have wheels on. You're just going down a highway real fast. There's no room for error.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much.
No, thank you, sir. Thank you.